As we welcome and greet people for this signing, we are going to sing together a song that was written by and will be led by my Yale classmate, Mark Miller, and it's called Welcome. Mark, thank you for leading us in our first song as we gather in together.
Let's walk together for a while and ask where we begin to build a world where love can grow and hope can enter in, to be the hands of healing and to seeds of peace, singing welcome, welcome to this place. You're invited to come and know God's grace. All are welcome, the love of God to share, 'cause all of us are welcome here. All are welcome
seated. Thank you very much, Mark. And I hope all of you noticed that Mark wrote that song himself. So it's a special, it's a song that we enjoy singing here at Yale Divinity School a great deal.
I want to welcome you to this signing ceremony. This is
actually the third
signing. The first was private.
It was a letter of intent that was signed in 2016 that launched a visiting year of Andover Newton at Yale Divinity School. The second
was public. The year had gone so well and things looked so promising that on July 20th in 2017, we gathered at the First Church of Christ in Glastonbury, Connecticut, and signed the agreement that has brought us to this day. It was a
5-year agreement that was coincident in time with the payments for the property, the sale of the property of the Andover Newton Theological School campus in Andover Center. But now we are ready for the final signing. And it's a very special moment. For some of us, there are emotions that are welling within us, thinking back over a period of literally 10 years. More on that a little bit later. But what we'll do is we're going to begin by actually signing the documents, and then we'll each call on one another to speak. And our first speaker will be President Peter Salove, who has joined us for this historic moment. He is the 23rd president of Yale. His term as president is interestingly coincident with the length of time that all of this process has been going on. And I want to publicly thank Peter for his support over all of this time, because he has never wavered in supporting this venture. But before Peter comes to the microphone, the first thing is to actually sign the document.
We have a few witnesses.
Just the
cloud.
We used pins that the provost made from trees here on the property of the Divinity School. This time we are signing with pins, and if you know your colors, you recognize this is Andover Newton. So we've now signed with Yale pins and Andover Newton, and I hope that this seals the deal. So I now call on President Salove to offer a few comments.
Thank you very much, Dean Sterling. Thank you all. Delighted we have reached this point, and a pleasure to be a co-signer with all of you. This has emotional resonance for me. My five great-grandfather built and was the first head of the, really the mother of all modern yeshivas in Europe. It was in Volozhin in Belarus, and built in, I think, 1803. And all what we, anytime you visit a yeshiva now, whether it's in Brooklyn or somewhere in Europe or elsewhere in Israel, that was the beginning. That yeshiva in Volozhin was the beginning of the modern modern movement in that kind of Orthodox Jewish education. Well, it's wonderful to see so many friends and to celebrate Andover Newton's permanent affiliation with the Yale Divinity School. Again, a special welcome to former and current trustees in particular of Andover Newton, as well as to the leaders of the transition team. Thank you for your partnership. Thank you for getting us to this point. I'm honored to join you. There are so many distinguished Andover Newton and YDS alumni who are streaming today's ceremony, and we welcome them too. Now, these proceedings mark officially the culmination of a six-year process, but in fact, these two institutions have been entwined for centuries because they share a common purpose. Both institutions were born of the same theological movement, less than a decade apart, in the early part of the 19th century. And both institutions made major contributions to theological education. Andover is the first American graduate school of any kind. YDS is responsible for producing more heads of colleges, universities, seminaries, and denominations than any of its domestic peers. And now in both eras, now in our era, both institutions are realizing anew a vision that was part of Andover's founding, a system of theological instruction more extended and complete than what was present in any other American seminary. And it is here, on this momentous occasion, that we bring that aspiration into fruition. It is here that we become not merely more extended or more complete, but altogether more excellent by unifying. In the years since our initial partnership began, these two institutions have enriched each other, and above all, enriched our student experience in myriad ways. I think, for instance, of the innovation Andover Newton has introduced into the Yale Divinity School's curriculum. Under Dean Sarah Drummond's visionary leadership and guided by the sage council of alumni with whom she conferred, Andover Newton pioneered yet another first by requiring Master of Divinity students to enroll in the Yale School of Management, in courses in the Yale School of Management. And this infused the benefits of business and management study into divinity education. Andover Newton has contributed immensely to our shared goal of keeping ministerial education affordable. Over one quarter of the funding that allows YDS to meet the full tuition need of all aided students emanates from Andover Newton. And this brings us closer to our goal of empowering graduates to choose their career paths on the basis of a calling rather than on inhibited by, I guess, financial constraints. Of course, for Andover Newton, the affiliation is a bold solution to the seismic shifts in theological education it detailed at the outset of the process. At a time when independent theological schools are seeking more sustainable ways to advance their missions, Andover Newton's affiliation with YDS positions it for future stability and sets a replicable example for peers to follow as they face similar obstacles related to enrollment and financial obligations. Indeed, by becoming a full partner with YDS, Andover Newton can now retain a historic mission that focuses squarely on equipping leaders for ministry. This is a mission that has maintained with steadfast conviction that has been maintained for three centuries and through three institutional identities. And it's a mission it can now continue to fulfill. I share in this broader university's, in the broader university community's fervent hope that this fourth iteration of an iconic theological institution will indeed be its final one. I share too in the delight to welcome Andover Newton to Yale, and its delight to welcome Andover Newton home. Thank you once again. Thank you once again for this partnership, for the special privilege of being able to join you in the signing ceremony and to speak a few words. Thank you so much. And now please join me in welcoming Dean Sterling to share his reflections on this historic partnership.
Thank you, President Salovey. Some of you may have an idea of just how difficult it is to get on his calendar. Multiply that by about four, and then you're probably close to accurate. We thank you for canceling some other things to be here today and to join us. Today marks the culmination of what I consider a 10-year process, six public, but four in private. So I'm going to just tell you a little bit about this process because some of you don't know what all has happened. At a meeting of the Dean's Advisory Council in the spring of 2013, I explained to the council why we were stopping conversations with a different institution about joining us. And at the end of that meeting, I approached one of the members of our council who also happened to be a trustee of Andover Newton Theological School, as it was then known, Martin Copenhaver. And I said to Martin, if Andover Newton is ever interested in having a conversation with us, we would be very eager. He thanked me politely and said nothing more for 2 years, during which time he was elected president of Andover Newton Theological School. And in the spring of 2015, Martin asked me, he said, do you remember that brief comment and conversation we had 2 years ago? Does that offer still stand? And I said, it does. So we arranged to have a very long lunch here in New Haven. And then I drove to Andover and met with Sarah and Martin and Jim Sherbloom, who was the chair of the Board of Trustees, for about a 2.5-3 hour meeting. It was a long meeting. And we were deciding whether to have further conversations or whether it was just nice to get acquainted and we would thank each other. And we decided we'd have further conversations. But they made it clear that they were thinking of different options and we were the third or fourth option. In other words, we were the last option. A couple of months later, I was sitting in an airport and my phone rang. It was Martin. Martin said, Greg, the board has decided to make the last option the first option. Well, that phone call set into place a great deal of activity. And I can't tell you everything that happened on the Andover side, just that there was a lot of activity, that I do know. But on the Yale side, it meant that every Friday morning for 2 years at 8 a.m., we met, a group of us met, representatives from general counsel, generally three attorneys, central finance, generally two people, the provost office, and representatives of Yale Divinity School and work through the issues from our perspective. But there were two moments in the history of all of the discussions when everything almost came apart. The first was on the Yale side. No one at Yale, whom I know of, was opposed to this. But there were several people, not President Salovey, several people who were wanting to slow everything down, but to slow it down to the point that it would have endangered the actual affiliation itself. So Martin and I talked, and we decided to have what he called a meeting of the families. He's watched Martin Scorsese's The Godfather a few times, I'm guessing. So we gathered in the room that we call the James Pennington Room. And I will say that that meeting, Sarah was there, that meeting went better than I had ever anticipated. And from that point on, Yale was fully behind these discussions. But there was another moment. Yale, and this is a long, complex story, which I'm not going to tell, but we decided that we could not accept another unit which would come as a separate legal unit. And that is today official Yale policy. But that posed a problem for the Andover Newton trustees because they are the legal representatives of that body. And I met Martin in San Antonio, Texas for a dinner. We were both there for a meeting of the Association of Theological Schools and broke all of this to Martin. I must have been too polite, I guess. I don't think it really sank in for a little while, but it did. And the board discussed this at great length for quite a while. And finally, in a unanimous vote, there was one abstention, in a unanimous vote, voted to proceed with that understanding. Now, the trustees are sitting here on the front row, and I want to tell you how much I admire your courage in making that step. Because there are far too many relationships that fall apart, and this can be one of the lines where they fall apart. But you made it possible by that courageous vote to be here today. And I thank you and applaud you. Now, this has come up, but you may be wondering, so why are we doing all of this today? And why are you telling us this now? Because last Friday, the board voted unanimously to ask a court in Massachusetts to dissolve their legal standing in Massachusetts because they have now received the final payment on their property. That was the last step, and all that remains is for a Massachusetts court to make a declaration for that to occur. I have to say, from my vantage point, this has gone far more smoothly and far better than I had anticipated, and I think than anyone had anticipated. It's a result of having a common intellectual and spiritual heritage that has allowed us to blend the two together. It is a result of great leadership. I want to say a special word of thanks and commendation to Sarah and to Martin. To get a standing ovation, just commend the right person. I also want to say a special word of thanks to the three chairs of the board of Andover Newton. I haven't seen Jim Sherbroom. I don't think he's here, but Linda Campanella and Hannah. They've been extraordinary to work with. There are many, many other people who have been involved, but I do want to recognize two people who are standing right back in front of the fireplace. Judy Sizer, who's been the legal counsel for Andover Newton, and Cynthia Carr, who has been the legal counsel representing Yale. And you can't imagine how many hours they have spent. And they have been invaluable in this entire process. Judy and Cynthia, our heartfelt thanks to both of you. There are many, many other people who've been heavily involved. This has been a lot of work, and it may look simple, but that's the way it's supposed to look on the outside. It hasn't always looked that way on the inside. But I see a number of people who were at that table at 8 a.m. for 2 years here from Yale and people from Andover. If you've been working on this at any point in the last 10 years, would you raise your hand so we could recognize you? Jennifer, hand up, please. Bill. Thank you. As I said in chapel earlier, we live in a world where the centrifugal forces appear to be much stronger than the centripetal forces. This is a moment when we celebrate the obverse and recognize that it is still possible to bring two very venerable institutions with their own quirks and their own traditions together. And I hope that this moment is a harbinger for what can happen with others in the future. So I say thank you to all who've been involved, and I call on Hannah King, who has led Andover's board in recent years, to now offer her remark. Hannah.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Dean Sterling, and thank you, President Salve, for being here with us today to mark this wonderful occasion. And thank you for all of you for being here to celebrate a momentous day, the culmination of fortitude, diligence, perseverance, and vision, and now illuminating a very bright future for both of us together. For the people gathered here and for the people joining us online, I want to thank you. Thank you for believing and having faith in this path and joining us to witness the signing of this agreement today. And to our alumni and faculty and staff, thank you as well. A special thank you to those who were back on the Hill who weren't able to make this journey with us. We acknowledge the difficulty of that. And to our alumni who may have wondered if this was the right path, I surely hope you believe it is now. So thank you for joining us. The road to this moment is one that's paved by the timely actions of so many amazing, supportive people, all committed to the future of Andover Newton and acutely aware of the importance of our mission. Our mission and our focus is not changing today. We remain deeply rooted in our Christian faith and radically open to what God is doing now. Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School educates inspiring leaders for faith communities. For all of the recent past trustees of Andover Newton Theological School who were chiefly focused on finding a bold new direction for us so that we could continue to fulfill our mission, to the last trustees of Andover Newton Theological School who, as Greg indicated, voted unanimously a week ago on the final permanent affiliation, thank you for all being ever faithful, focused, and forward-looking. It is deeply appreciated. It's also exciting to be experiencing already the success of this affiliation, the vibrancy of our program here, the caliber of our inspiring students, and the sense of community and belonging. It's palpable when you walk through the doors. Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School has grown and flourished, and we are focused on shaping our now certain future. We will continue to keep our students, those inspiring faith leaders we all need, at the very epicenter of all that we do. We are proud of our role in helping to eliminate student debt. That was a common cause that we both felt strongly about and that we have been able to achieve. And I thank you for noting Andover Newton's role in that. We are so very proud of it, and it inspires such hope for our students' ability in the future to leave here and go do what they feel called to do instead of what they feel they must do. We're also very proud of our $1 million pledge to the Living Village and to be a part of that and anxious to break ground and to see that structure bloom. We're also very proud recently having been able to put another $4.7 million of investments into our existing Abbott chair and into a newly endowed George Washington Williams chair, named for an amazing man who was a pastor, a statesman, a historian, and an advocate for the freedom of all people, and a graduate, our first African-American graduate of Andover Newton in 1874. This chair will be focused on historically underrepresented communities. And as a brief aside, Sarah and I and Ned would be very happy to speak to anyone so moved here today to continuing to make a gift towards that. I'm sure Barb or Sabia would be appreciative of that too. To our partners at Yale, I have so often been reminded during the last 6 years of working together to the song that Rascal Flatts sings, Bless the Broken Road, which includes the lyrics that God bless the broken road that led me straight to you. And you acknowledged the three chairs of the board, Linda, Jim, and myself, who have been part of this affiliation process. But I also need to acknowledge the other board chairs who were part of the roads not taken process. And thank you, Judy and Dave, and I don't believe I'm missing anyone else here, but those were trying years. But without the work that you did, we wouldn't be standing here today. So thank you very much. Our path together to affiliation has always felt right to me, all along. And I don't say that to minimize all of the work, the family talks, as Martin called them, and the negotiations, sometimes quite strenuous and difficult, that took to get to this place. But I do believe, being a business major, that the business case of this affiliation always made sense. That both Andover Newton and Yale benefited in ways that both President Salovey and Dean Sterling have articulated, and I know that Dean Drummond will as well. However, history is littered with squandered and missed opportunities because the right people were not at the table at the right time with the right focus. Both Andover, through exemplary leadership and the ability to both pivot and stand firm at the same time, sometimes simultaneously, and most importantly, the deep devotion of four principal individuals, former board chair Jim Sherbloon, my friend and former board chair Linda Campanella, our former president of Andover Theological School, Martin Copenhaver, and our founding dean, Sarah Drummond. And at Yale Divinity School, Dean Sterling, your vision and your continuous well of willingness to find a path, along with the support of your leadership team and Yale University's blessing, and I thank you, President Salovey, for always supporting this. All of these people were in the right place at the right time, and we should be forever grateful for their wisdom, their skill, and their doggedness to see this through. I thank each and every one of you for your role in that. I'm also very grateful to the select Andover Newton trustees that began serving in 2016 on a strategic negotiations task force to help negotiate on behalf of our school. Somewhat ironically to my role here today, I was asked to head the Andover Newton Alternatives Task Force so that if early negotiations broke down with Yale, Andover Newton would have another alternative. Clearly, I spent very little time working on that initiative. Likewise, thank you to the trustees, Jeff Hagrey, Mike Kellogg, and Dave Smith for your work this last year to finalize our agreement, and to our counterparts at Yale, Nancy Taylor, Emily Bakemeyer, Joyce Mercer, and John Sagnimich. Thank you. And finally, I'd like to thank two other key people who Dean Sterling has also already recognized, with Cynthia Carr and Judy Sizer. Thank you for beginning and ending this with us. We're very grateful for your work. Before Andover Newton permanently left Newton, and during an executive committee meeting at which we were discussing President Martin Copenhaver, a particular element he brought to us regarding the negotiations, the executive committee, and Linda and I were members of that at the time, noted to Martin that it would be really important for him to write an account of the affiliation between Andover Newton Theological School and Yale Divinity School, that it was worth noting what it is that we all had been through. Recognizing the challenging environment for standalone theological schools, the historic nature of this affiliation, and the work of so many to make it happen, this accounting would serve as both a business case study of how we got it done, but also as a historical account for future generations to understand. Due to confidentiality issues between our agreement, which I think we just released when we signed that, This has still been an internal document for those of us on the board to look at. It's about 100 pages, and it is a document that I have read and referred to several times in the last few years myself. As Martin began writing that narrative in his first year of retirement, Dean Sarah Drummond had suggested to Martin that he read Everett Carlton Herrick's memoir, Turns Again Home, which focused on the affiliation between Newton Theological Institution, where Herrick served as president, and Andover Theological Seminary. Herrick wrote in his account in 1949, soon after he retired, and Martin noted in his own accounting of our affiliation, I quote, "With stunning frequency, Herrick's words found echoes in my own experience, reminding me that others had journeyed this way before. At time, we may have thought we were doing something new, but as scripture reminds us, what has been is what will be, and what has been done is what will be done. There is nothing new under the sun." Ecclesiasticals for anyone who wants to note. Martin then continued, "Herrick concluded in his memoir with this sentence, the tide of memory flows back into the inlet of long ago and turns again home. In affiliating with Yale," Martin notes, "Andover Newton had found a new home. In other respects, however, the affiliation resembles a homecoming, back to our deepest roots and to our founding mission. And so the tide of both memory and of events turns again home, again." Martin titled his account for us, "Turns Again, Home Again." And I think there is no better conclusion to my remarks than to say, I'm happy we're home. And now it's my honor to introduce someone that each of you in this room knows well, our founding dean of Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School, Sarah Drummond.
A person who loves stories about people and history, and religious types tend to be, I imagine you get a little weak in the knees over a good origin story. Whether it's Greek mythology, Aesop's fables, or the Marvel Cinematic Universe, we find a satisfying sense of completeness when we know where something we care about came from. Today, you've heard several examples of the kinds of dots we can connect backward to demonstrate how Andover Newton Seminary and Yale Divinity School found each other to be the right partners for this moment in the shared endeavor to educate religious leaders. But when was the die really cast? What launched the arrow that today found its target? Well, anybody with a good liberal arts education, and I have one, thanks be to God, my parents, and Yale, could make a case that any number of events sealed this deal long ago. You heard Dean Gregory Sterling talk about his address 10 years ago that got the attention of my predecessor and former colleague, Martin Copenhaver. It sparked the talks that led to today's signing of a permanent affiliation agreement. I remember a conversation I had with Harry Attridge in 2007. Don't know if he remembers it, but I do. When he was chairing the accreditation team that was visiting Andover Newton Seminary, while he was at that time serving as dean of YDS. We talked over punch and cookies about both of our institutions' concerns about the mounting seminary debt that was likely to place a lifelong burden on our graduates. Did we look at each other then and say, oh, we should talk about joining forces? Of course not. But now I look back on moments like those as glimmers of light that guided us onto a path that we now walk on together today. If we really want to talk origin story, however, we have to go much deeper into the past. The real Big Bang that arguably put this partnership into motion was a quiet collision in the 18th century between reason and faith. Today, we have names for the vehicles involved in that collision. The Enlightenment was an era of great advances in human knowledge and self-congratulation for the same. The Great Awakening was a time of faith revival, where Christian communities reclaimed the emotional and metaphysical dimensions of the Christian religious experience. In the run-up to the Industrial Revolution and its stunning advances in human achievement, thought leaders at Yale and the churches of New England, most notably fire and brimstone preacher Jonathan Edwards, had a sneaking suspicion that this modernity thing was going to present Christianity with some challenges. Those same thought leaders saw an intersection point between human achievement and faith that others, including our chilly neighbors to the north in Cambridge, had somehow missed. And that intersection was beauty and awe and wonder and inspiration. We can love God through an appreciation of creation so passionate that we want to understand everything about it. Yale found a capacity to live at that intersection of faith and reason, rather than choosing between the academy or the church, Lux or Veritas. It became a new haven. A new haven in which faith was understood to enhance rather than undermine intellectual achievement. Schools like Andover and Newton were among the planets that emerged from that Big Bang. I and many, many others devoted thousands of hours to this affiliation negotiation, but that's not why the negotiations succeeded. No matter the field, coalitions and mergers require hard work, but they rise and fall based on cultural fit and, in our case, a shared theological worldview. We have that, and it's made all the difference. We share a common theology as well as common enemies. At the hands of modernity, the idea that intellect and awe both have a place in the setting of higher and highest learning, that went from being ordinary to being countercultural. Resisting the encroachment of false binaries between belief and understanding will require energy and mutual encouragement. Schools that care about wonder need to get together, and they need to stick together. When it comes to religious expression in America, something is dying, and something new is being born. We can all sense it, and yet we don't know what God is doing. We have the capacity together to provide this moment with capable midwives, ready to assist in the delivery of what God is bringing to life. And because we can, and because it's important, we must do this work. And we must do it together. I now will close with a word of blessing. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May God lift up the light of God's countenance upon you, grant you peace, and invite you to rise in body or spirit to sing our closing song with Mark Miller. Amen.
Words before this end, you know my and bases all my days.